Welcome, everybody, to another episode of the Do Hard Things podcast. I'm your host, Jay Teague, certified high performance coach, transformational mindset coach. In this episode of the podcast, I have a great conversation with author and former attorney general for the state of Nevada, George Chanos. Before we get there, if you haven't done so already, please be sure to subscribe to the podcast so you're notified of future episodes. Leave a review. They go a long way for us to expand our reach of the podcast and share it with a couple of your friends. Take a screenshot and share this episode with a couple of your friends. And I would love to hear from you, like what takeaway or nugget did you get away, did you take away from today's show? And you can reach out to me. You can go to jteagues.com. You can find me on all social media platforms. And also, if you like the Do Hard Things logo and you would like a shirt or some merchandise, a hat, a sticker, a patch, check out the store. You can go down in the show notes and link to the store and grab yourself some merch so you show the world that you do hard things. So in today's episode, I have a great conversation with former Attorney General for the state of Nevada, George Chanos, and I'm going to read to you his bio. So as Nevada's 31st Attorney General, he administered Nevada's Department of Justice and acted as the state's chief legal officer and advisor. While serving as the Nevada's Attorney General, he successfully argued 9-0 the case of Horton versus Bochting, 59 U.S. 406, 2007, before the Supreme Court of the United States. Prior to serving as Nevada's Attorney General, Mr. Chanos had a distinguished legal career representing individual and corporate clients on all matters relating to the growth and management of their businesses. He is an author, speaker, and business consultant. He served on numerous boards, both civic and corporate, for the last 10 years, and has also served as chairman of Capriotti's Sandwich Shop, a rapidly growing 100-plus unit franchise whose millennial owners, his partners, he continues to advise and mentor. Mr. Chanos is a father and uncle. His daughter, Alexandra, is currently attending the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, and his nephew, David, is a graduate of San Diego State University. They're both millennials and are an inspiration for his book, Millennial Samurai, which we talk about in this particular episode. Millennial Samurai is a mindset for the 21st century. And what this book will enable you to learn is learning the mindsets that will help you overcome your fears, control your thoughts, and prepare yourself for the major changes that are coming. And one of the great aspects of this conversation and the topic is really, you know, we're currently living in a technological revolution. Things are changing at a rapid pace. And Millennium Samurai is an excellent book that will give you the tools that you need. What is the mindset needed to navigate this ever-changing technological landscape? There's so many things happening at such a rapid pace that we need to be better equipped to handle with these changes, because there's a lot of things that are changing, whether we like it or not. And this book does a great job of outlining the different virtues and principles and characteristics that you need, how to sharpen your sword, because samurai is a warrior and your sword is the tool that you're going to use to navigate this. So how do you sharpen your sword? And then a lot of various aspects, his interpretation of what we need to be focused on right now. He gives a lot of great insight from his perspective as a politician or being a former working in politics. And yeah, there's so many great nuggets of information in this interview. So I'm excited about it. Without further ado, let's get into today's episode. All right. Welcome back, everyone, to another episode of the Do Hard Things podcast. I'm your host, Jay Teague, certified high performance coach, transformational mindset coach. And in this episode, I have special guest, former attorney general for the state of Nevada, George Chanos. George, thanks for being here with us today.
Thank you for having me, Jay.
So tell us a little bit about who you are, maybe what you're working on right now.
Okay. So who I am, let's see. I'm a kid from Wisconsin, Wauwatosa, Wisconsin, who ultimately had a dream of becoming president when I was very young. It was during the Kennedy assassination. I was with my mom. She pulled the car over to the side of the road when it came over the radio and started crying and left a big impression on me. and kind of set my life in motion. And I was wondering what, you know, this tremendous outpouring of grief and love was for this fallen hero, and I wanted to be like him. And so it attracted me to politics, and I set out to pursue that goal, actually established the goal of becoming president in the year 2000. I would be 42 years old. I would be younger than 1 year younger than JFK. This is all the dream of a six-year-old. And so, I mean, a six-year-old who grows to 10 and then to 12 and then continues to harbor this dream. And so I set out on that path, and I followed certain steps. I became student body president and at the university in college, and then class president in law school, and went out to work for Senator Paul Laxalt between the two. And I was working in Washington, D.C., and it was during Abscam. And it was the political corruption scandal that ensnarled a bunch of congressmen, and they were resigning in front of a international press corps in the Russell Senate office building when I was there. And that was another epiphany moment for me. I saw the looks on the faces of these people, and I didn't want to be one of them. So I decided that the way you avoid that, at least for me, was to go out and make money, because I didn't want to give up on the thought of having money. Which would be another way to go. You just give up on the thought of having money, and like a monk that takes a vow of poverty, that would also protect you from graft and corruption. And another form of protection is you have your own money, so that you don't need someone else's money, and you don't need to, you know, succumb to temptation. And so I went off in that path and became a successful lawyer and businessman, and got to the point where I felt I could sit across the table from anyone and be in office and not be tempted in any way to take money from anyone. So under those terms, I got into politics. I was appointed by the governor to fill the vacancy of an individual who was the attorney at the time. He was appointed to become a federal judge, created a two-year vacancy, and I was asked to fill that vacancy, which I shut down my law practice and took the job as Nevada's attorney general. And then when I got in, I realized that it was far worse than I had understood it to be. And I had understood it to be pretty bad, but not as bad as I found it to be. I knew that there was special interest influence, but not at the level that that I discovered. And so I decided that it wasn't for me anymore. It's not something that I wanted to be part of my life. I felt that in order to succeed in that realm, I would have to do things that would compromise me and my values. And so I decided not to do it, not to go that direction. And it's sad. It's a sad commentary on politics today. But essentially, to move up in the political system, you have to go along to get along. And you have to, you know, follow the directives of the political leadership in your party. And I wasn't a ideologue. I'm a centrist. I come from the proposition that we have 335 million people in the United States, 7.5 billion people globally, and that no one who is on one side of the equation in an equally divided country is going to lead that entire country forward. That you really have to come from the center. If you've got 180 million people who think one way, and you have 180 million people who lean in the opposite direction, then someone from one side or the other is not going to lead that entire group very effectively. They have to instead understand that they represent all of us. They represent everyone in the United States, and they need to pay attention to everyone's needs and wants and desires and thoughts and opinions, and weigh those in arriving at the best ideas for everyone. Take the best ideas from the left, take the best ideas from the right, and lead from the center. And that wasn't happening, and it's still not happening. And so I left politics, and I became nonpartisan. I no longer am a member of either party, nor will I join either party. So politically, that's where I am. Now, I still want to make a contribution to society, which is what I wanted to do when I was six. And so I'm determined to still try to make a contribution. I just want to do it outside of politics. And so I began to write. What happened to me was I actually had a heart attack in 2012. And my daughter was 15 at the time. And I was concerned that if I had died, what would happen to my daughter and who would advise her moving forward? And so I began to write a letter to her, and I tried to anticipate the issues that she might confront and to offer an opinion on those issues in the event that I wasn't there to answer her questions directly. And that letter, ultimately, because I like to write, that letter became very long. And once it became over 100 pages, I realized this is looking more like a book. And I had never written a book. But I thought, you know what, I'll turn this into a book and I'll leave my daughter a book. And so I did that. And that became my first book, a book called Seize Your Destiny, A Roadmap to Success. And that's essentially a book for someone who's under 18 years old. Mostly, it could be for anyone, really. I've had people that are much older that have gotten a lot out of Seize Your Destiny. But I wrote it for someone who was under 18 years old. And so that, you know, kind of downloaded what I had learned during my life, during my 30 years of professional practice and work. And I had succeeded in downloading that information in Seize Your Destiny. What I realized when I finished it was that the world that my daughter was going to live in was a world that was very different than the world that I had grown up in, very different. And so I wanted to know what that world was going to look like, and see if I could advise her on what that world would require of her. And so I started looking at the future, and I spent about 5 years delving into what's going to happen over the next 30 years. And I started to write about that. And that became my second book, and that's called Millennial Samurai, A Mindset for the 21st Century. This is a copy of Millennial Samurai. And essentially, it is, if I were to drop you off in the Amazon and I were going to give you a duffel bag, we can both think of what types of things I would include in that duffel bag, right? I'd include water, I'd include something to start a fire, I'd include, you know, some sharp instruments and a compass and different things that someone would need to survive in the Amazon. Well, Millennial Samurai, this book, is my duffel bag that I'm leaving to my daughter. And quite honestly, first of all, I want you to understand, nobody makes money writing a book, okay? The very, very few people make money writing a book. Amazon, an independent author, sells less than 100 books in his lifetime. And so it's not a road to riches. It's a road to legacy. And it's an opportunity to leave something behind that can help and enrich others. And so when I finished Millennial Samurai and I realized what I had written, I realized that this was actually the most valuable thing that I will be leaving my daughter. It's more valuable than the home that she'll inherit or any of the wealth that she'll inherit. If I could only leave her one thing, I would leave her this book. And if I can think, and if I have to point to one thing that I've done in my life so far that I think will ultimately prove most important, it's not my service as Nevada's Attorney General. It's not arguing before the United States Supreme Court and winning 9-0. It's this book. It's really this book, you know, because this book has the power to change lives. I really believe that moments can change people's lives. You can hear something. You can read something. You can see something, you can experience something that will create an epiphany moment, like my car ride when I was 6 years old, or my elevator ride when I was 20. These were both pivotal moments in my life. They changed the course and trajectory of my life. And so moments, I know for a fact that moments change lives. And I've heard from other speakers who have talked about the moments in their lives where someone, Les Brown, talks about a moment with Mr. Washington, one of his teachers, when he was called on at class, and the children started laughing, and Les Brown said, "I don't know the answer, Mr. Washington. I'm stupid." And the teacher said, "Well, what do you mean you're stupid?" And he said, "Well, everybody says I'm stupid." And Mr. Washington said, "Don't ever allow the opinions of others to determine how you think about yourself." And that was an epiphany moment for Les Brown, right? So we all have these moments. And I believe that Millennial Samurai is filled with these moments. And that as people read it, there will be passages that will speak to them. And it's a very easy read. It's broken down into 182 chapters that are only 1 to 3 pages each. So it's very easy to read. You read one or two chapters, you become hooked on the value proposition. You end up getting more out of reading the chapter than the time that you invested in reading that chapter, because it's so short and so filled with relevant information, and it gets right to the point. There's not a lot of verbosity or extra padding. Someone once told me that what they loved about my books is that, you know, they'll read a book on positive thinking, and it might be 200 pages on positive thinking, and they'll come away feeling, I learned in the first 10 pages what I needed to know from that book on positive thinking. I didn't need 200 pages, right? And that's what I think is the beauty of Millennial Samurai, is that by breaking things down in 1 to 3 page chapters, you have to write it almost like a haiku poetry. You have to distill the essentials. For example, there are a University of Pennsylvania professors who wrote a book on character, and they spent 800 pages on talking about character. So character, you can go on and on and on about, you know, how important it is, and give endless examples of how important it is. But how can you take that concept and in 1 to 3 pages convince a young person or a reader of any age that character is an essential element in their life that has to be incorporated into their life in order for them to have a successful and happy and meaningful life? So that was the challenge of Millennial Samurai. And when you read it, I think you'll get a tremendous amount out of it. So that's mostly what I've been doing. What I'm doing now is going to take us into a whole different rabbit hole. What I'm doing now is I'm chairman of the board of a company called Capriati's, which is the fastest growing QSR in the United States. I'm chairman of a company called Wingzone, which we've recently acquired and have plans for that are very similar to those of Capriati's, high growth and expansion, rapid high growth and expansion. We've taken these companies from a $10 million company to what we now believe is over a $100 million company. I've got two young guys that run these companies and a seasoned veteran that we've brought in as well that runs these companies with them. And I serve on the board and act as an advisor to them. I've been doing that for 12 years. But they're brilliant young men, and they're doing an incredible job in growing the company. And we've assembled an amazing board. And then I've now, in addition to my writing, I was speaking. I was speaking around the country, but because of COVID, that's been cut down. And then along came blockchain and NFTs. And I started looking at that. And it fit very well into what I like to do with my time and what I feel I'm good at. And so I decided to get into the NFT arena and to try to look at it like a puzzle and to try to solve the puzzle and to try to figure out what my entry point might be and to try to figure out what kind of a legacy I could leave there and to see if there was also a business opportunity, which I believe there is. And I'm also an artist. I paint, I do sculptural assemblage, I make jewelry. I have a very heavy emphasis on creativity in my life. And so NFTs were perfect for me because they were a business. They allowed me to be creative, and they also allow me to leave a legacy. They're like planting seeds on the blockchain, and who knows where they'll go or how they'll grow. So that's what I'm doing today.
You got your fingers in a lot of different things. It's awesome. How do you get so much done? We'll get into the high performance at the end of this. I always ask like high performance questions, but you're a man that takes on a lot, and you're obviously very successful in the things that you do. And I'm glad that you brought up the blockchain and NFTs. And with all of that, I'm trying to figure out where to start here. But before we get into that, I do want to go back in time and touch on a moment that you talked about. I remember when I think I was 6 years old, 5 years old. I was in kindergarten and watching TV one day, the Challenger blew up. And I remember that moment because I remember my teacher in absolute tears and just everyone, the shock and horror of that event. And it was probably the first moment that I remember where something that had happened in the news had an effect on everyone around me. And you mentioned the JFK assassination. I wasn't alive then. Could you just describe the story? Like, what were you doing? What were your thoughts and feelings? Then when you saw your mom crying, how did that, because that deeply affected you to a point that at 6 years old, it sent you down a trajectory of politics.
Yeah.
Can you just describe that moment?
Yeah, I can describe it pretty vividly. I was 6 years old, and we were driving down Paradise Road in Las Vegas, Nevada. We were driving a blue convertible with a white top. I believe it might have been an Impala. I'm not sure of the type of the car, but it was a blue convertible, a baby blue convertible that my mom owned. And we're driving down Paradise Road. There were not a lot of people in Las Vegas at the time. So the road was fairly, you know, not busy. And all of a sudden it comes over the radio, and I'm not sure if it was who the announcer was, obviously, but they were saying, we have a special announcement. The president of the United States, John F. Kennedy, has been shot. And then they started to describe it. And then, you know, my mom burst into tears and pulled the car to the side of the road. And she sat there moping and crying, you know, in a way that I had never seen. And eventually she pulled herself together, and we drove back to our little apartment. And she turned on the news immediately when she walked in the door. And I parked myself in front of the television set for the next 2 weeks. And I watched the outpouring of love and respect and grief for this fallen hero. There was a world that was mourning for the death of this man. And it was global. And it was profound. I remember the funeral procession and the, you know, the riderless horse. And I remember John Jr., you know, saluting his father. And these were very, very touching moments. And it was just, it had an impact on me. I thought, you know, why is the world so grief-stricken and so enthralled with this man? And I didn't quite understand the reason, you know, at all, really, at 6 years old. But I just understood that he must have been somebody special. And I thought, wow, you know, it'd be really nice to be that person, right? Even the fact that he died did not deter me from wanting to be just like him. You know, I felt that that would be a fair trade-off for a life well lived, you know? And so anyway, that's the impact that that moment had on me.
Yeah, I've been down to Dealey Plaza and just, you know, studying that historical event. I've been kind of fascinated with it. And as vitriolic as politics have been in my lifetime, you know, when I hear people make snide comments like that, they wish the president was dead or something like that, I'm like, I couldn't think of a worse thing to think about. And I pray to God that we never have to experience anything like that again, but because that was such a pivotal moment, and just seeing how it deeply affected people. And I'm always fascinated to hear people's story, like where they were on that particular day. Just like, you know, where were you? I mean, the generation before us, you know, where were they on Pearl Harbor? And then we have 9/11. And that was just one of those moments, like people know where they were and how it impacted them. So,
yeah. And it's not that, you know, I was a Democrat at 6 years old. It wasn't a political affiliation issue. I didn't know the difference between a Republican and a Democrat when I was 6 years old. I just knew that this man was the leader of the free world, and he came from America, and he died, and the world mourned. And that's all I knew at six.
Yeah. Well, it's amazing how that impacted you and put you on a certain trajectory in your life.
Yeah.
And,
so, well, the lesson there for all of us is that moments do change lives. You know, they really do. And so you can create a moment or you can experience a moment. Mm-hmm. And either one of those can have a huge impact on your life. So you can create a moment for someone else that can change their life. Or you can be the person whose life is changed by a moment that you experience. And just be aware of it and understand that it's real. And, you know, sometimes you look for those moments, and, you know, while you're reading or while you're studying, you're looking for information that might be life-changing. It's called breakthrough knowledge, frankly. And breakthrough knowledge normally comes in the form of disconfirming information. This is how science progresses, right? So we think a certain way. And then we read something or learn something that causes us to think a different way. And that's called breakthrough knowledge. We find out that the way we were thinking before was wrong and that there's this new way of thinking. And, you know, for example, your comment about people who might, you know, wish a president is dead or say something like that, and they shouldn't say that. Maybe somebody hearing that could have a breakthrough moment, a breakthrough knowledge moment, where that resonates with them and they realize that you're right, and they shouldn't think that way, right? So it's interesting how the mind, the human mind, works. It's very susceptible to suggestion. It's very susceptible to manipulation. There's a lot about the human brain that we could talk about. It's all in the book. It's in Millennial Samurai. This is why the book is such an important tool, is because it teaches you things that you don't know, right? Like, you may not know that your brain receives 11 million bits of information per second. This has been happening since you were born. And your five senses acquire that information through your environment, and then they deliver it into the brain. And then the brain acquires that information and is influenced by that information. And then you're influenced by how the brain is influenced, because the brain controls all of your behavior and thoughts. And so it's all a product of the information that is delivered to you. And not only do you receive that volume of information, but roughly 99% of that information comes into your brain outside of your conscious awareness, because your conscious brain can only process 15 to 50 bits of information per second. So if you can only consciously process 15 to 50 bits and you have 11 million bits coming in, then, you know, the math is pretty simple. Virtually everything is coming in through your unconscious brain. Very little is coming in through your conscious brain. And if that information is coming in through your unconscious brain and you're unaware of it, then the opportunity for manipulation and for suggestion are profound. And then if you add to that the influence of social media, the advent of social media, your phone now has 100,000 times the computing power that NASA had in 1969 when it put men on the moon. So you have this tremendous, powerful tool in your hands, and virtually all of us have one. And now people can reach us through this instrument without gatekeepers. which means they don't have to go through the news. They don't have to go through Fox or CNN or MSNBC or the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal to reach you. They can go through your phone directly, and they can bring that information to you. You can be watching TikTok for an hour, and you'll be fed a series of videos that will influence your thought processes subconsciously, both consciously and subconsciously. And you wouldn't even be aware of some of the influences that this is having on your mind. And so we have how many millions of children and young people and people of all ages who are on, you know, Facebook and Instagram and Snapchat and TikTok, and what kind of an influence is that having on our population? We don't really know. We don't understand the true magnitude of the significance of this event. But this is technology. This is the first wave of the technological revolution. And I would argue that it's already having a very dramatic effect on our country and on the world. And suicide rates for certain age groups have tripled. Part of that is social media and the influence that it's having. This is a technological instrument that is changing the way we live and the way we think and the way we act and the way we work. A lot of young people aren't even using their phone to have conversations anymore. They're texting. They rarely speak on their phones. They just text. And so that's affecting communication. I have met some young people that spend their whole day in the room on their phone or their laptop. And when they come out of the room and greet you, it's hard for them to even establish eye contact or have a meaningful conversation because they're not accustomed to it. And those skills have begun to atrophy. And so these are all things that are going on in the world that we live in today. And I look at the phone as the first wave of the technological revolution. There was personal computing, and then there was the internet, and then there was mobile computing, and now we're into blockchain, and next we're going into the spatial web. And so this is an evolution of technology that will change the world that we live in over the next several decades in a way that makes it almost unrecognizable to what has existed in our past. So the life that I grew up with or in is most certainly very different than the life that your children will grow up in and the world that they will experience. It will be very, very different. And so we need to adapt as a species to these changes and to this evolution that is being accelerated by technology. And it's, you know, people listen to this or they hear this, and some of them might be frightened or some of them might be disappointed because we like the world we grew up in. We like our children playing outside, you know, free from harm. And we don't want to think about some of these challenges. But it will also open up great opportunities that have never existed before. Tremendous opportunities. For example, Ray Kurzweil talks about nanobots in the 2040s, which is 20 to 30 years away. Nanobots pulsing through our bloodstreams, curing all of our diseases. The technology that the mRNA technology that has been developed for the vaccines has incredible potential. Gene sequencing and CRISPR and technologies that allow for people to change the chemistry and the molecular structure and the DNA of the species have tremendous implications. So all of this longevity, there's a guy named Aubrey de Grey at the SENS Research Foundation who says that the first person who will live to 1,000 is alive today, meaning a baby that is born today, which has an anticipated lifespan of, say, 90 years, 100 years, that over that 90 to 100 years, advances in genomics will be such that that lifespan will be able to be increased from 100 years to 1,000 years. Now, let's say he's wrong. Let's say it's only double what it is today, and you live to 200 years. That's just a monumental change. Kurzweil says that not only that the singularity, the moment in time when machine intelligence will eclipse human intelligence, will come as early as 2029, and Hawking called that the greatest event in human history, that it would be the greatest event in human history. But Kurzweil goes on to say that by the 2040s, again, 20 to 30 years away, artificial intelligence will not be our equal. It will become our equal, and then it will surpass us. And within a 20-year period after becoming our equal, it will be a billion times more capable than human intelligence, a billion times. That our neural cortex will be connected to the cloud, that everything you know, I'll know, and that everything I know, you'll know. And so this is the future that's being painted for us by some of the brightest people in the world who have a greater understanding of artificial intelligence and technology than the rest of us. There's a thing called decision intelligence. Artificial intelligence makes possible decision intelligence, where we may not be the people making the decisions on certain things. I've read articles about application in the military field where this may become automated, where our response to an attack might be an automated response as opposed to a command response. Because the delay of even a few moments could make the difference between success or failure. And so we may have to have artificial intelligence that is responding to an attack in nanoseconds. And so, you know, all of these things create opportunities and they create challenges. And it's all a matter of mindset and perception and how you look at things and how you choose to respond to things. Leaders don't run from problems. Leaders run at problems. And so that's a mindset, you know, that you need to develop if you want to lead, is that you need to be someone who embraces challenge, who understands how they can impact challenge, and who believes in themselves and in others, and in our collective ability to overcome these challenges and to create great opportunities for the country and for the world. And I'm one of those people that is optimistic about our future. I look forward to these opportunities and challenges where others may fear them. So it's really a question of mindset.
Yeah, I think about my breakthrough moment and studying human behavior and mindset at my lowest point in life. So I've made it, it's part of my learning now. And it's ultimately why I got down this path of performance coaching, because mindset is everything. And what I appreciate about, the William Samurai and the teachings, and it was one of your posts recently, which compelled me to reach out to you, was that we have got to, you know, get a handle on our mindset in order to stay ahead and keep up with the technological advances that are happening, because they're happening at such a fast, rapid pace. And you bring up some great points about, you know, we live in the most abundant time in the history of mankind, you know, in a wonderful nation with so many opportunities, yet the suicide rate is tripled in some segments. And so what are some of your greatest concerns with the advancement of technology? What do you think are some things that we need to be concerned with?
Yeah, it's not so much the advances in technology that concern me. It's the frailty of the human species and the limitations on our ability to adapt, the perceived limitations on our ability to adapt. So someone who's committing suicide feels powerless to adapt to their environment. Whatever their environment is, has become overwhelming to them, right? It's become overwhelming. And that is a state of mind. That's a state of mind. It's not the external conditions that are actually overwhelming, because we know that there are people who deal with all sorts of misfortune. There are people who lose all of their limbs, all of them, and they deal with it, right? There are people who lose all of their limbs and fly planes, right? So it's really not a question of the external challenges. It's a question of the fortitude of the individual and the ability of the individual to adapt and to overcome those challenges. I believe that we are inherently incredibly adaptive creatures. I mean, if you think about it, from the moment that you're born, okay, you are released from your mother's womb, right? Which was all warm and cozy and liquid, and you know, you're attached to a umbilical cord and your every need was being satisfied without anything required on your part, right? All of a sudden, you are essentially released from that environment. And now you're out in an oxygen-filled environment that it isn't warm, there isn't water, and now you're spit out and you're cut from your mother's umbilical cord, and you're expected to adapt. You're expected to adapt to this completely new and foreign environment, right? And you do. You do, and you do it successfully. We all do it, right? So that to me tells us, or it tells me, that we are capable of incredible adaptation from birth, right? So now, over time, imagine if we were to perfect that skill set, that adaptive skill set, right? How adaptive could we become? Right? And I think we could become incredibly adaptive, right? It's all part of how you think and how you approach problems and what you believe, what your belief system is. So let's start with belief. Oprah Winfrey was interviewed in 2014 at Stanford University, and she was asked by a graduate student about the failures of her philanthropic investments in Africa. Right? She had invested millions of dollars in building a library and a girls' school in Africa. And it turns out no one came, no one attended, right? Not no one. I mean, some attended, but nowhere near the success that she had envisioned, not at a level that justified perhaps that level of investment, right? So what did she learn from that? She was asked, and she said, "I learned that in order to succeed in life, you first have to believe in your ability to succeed. You have to have a sense of hopefulness and a sense of aspiration, right? If you don't have a sense of hopefulness and a sense of aspiration, and you don't believe in your ability to succeed, then you won't succeed. As Henry Ford once said, if you think you can, whether you think you can or you think you can't, you're right. You know, if you think you can, you're right. And if you think you can't, you're right. You know, it's all, what do you believe, right? So that's the beginning of a well-lived life and of a successful and adaptive life is belief. Belief in yourself and belief in others, okay? I have always had an extraordinary level of belief in myself. How does a six-year-old think he can be president, right? I just believed in myself. You know, I don't know where it came from, but I believed in myself. And that belief has served me incredibly well. And so we need that. And how many people in the world today don't believe in themselves, right? We've got over 20 million fatherless children in the United States. We've got over 5 million homeless children in the United States, right? There's a lack, there is a sense of hopelessness and a lack of aspiration among many millions of people. And that is a crippling mindset. It's a mindset that's debilitating. It can prevent you, even when you're given opportunities, from succeeding and availing yourself of those opportunities. So first you have to believe, and you should believe, because I believe there is greatness in all of us. I believe that it's an untapped reservoir that exists in all of us, and it's our job to open that up. And to reveal it, understand that greatness, that capacity for greatness, and then build on it, sharpen your sword. So in Millennial Samurai, I talk about sharpening your sword, right? Your brain is a tool. It's an instrument. It can be a weapon. It can be a defensive tool. It can protect you and advance you. In all situations, it's always with you, even when you have nothing else with you, even when you have no food, no housing, no clothing, nothing, you have your brain, right? So you carry it everywhere you go. It's your most important tool. So why wouldn't you feed it? Why wouldn't you strengthen it, right? So you want to devour information. Information is how you learn. And you can devour information through your five senses in a number of ways. It doesn't all have to be reading, right? Some of it should be reading. There's vast amounts of information available for you to read. There are also incredible experiences throughout your life for you to learn through, right? So every time you travel, every time you meet a new person, every time you taste a new food, every time you hear a new song, every time you see a new movie or play, you're learning something new. New information is coming into that brain. You're feeding that brain. And you know, kids today, we look at school. I remember when I was in school, I wasn't really a very good student. There were certain subjects that I thought, oh, I don't need to know that. I'm not interested in that. Even in law school, I knew that I would never practice criminal law. So I didn't pay attention to criminal law. I didn't study it like I studied contract law, right? Well, what I've now learned is that you don't pick what you learn based on what you believe will be its application to you in the future. You look at learning as anything that you do, any information that you learn is sharpening your sword. It is increasing your capacity to learn. So if you learn algebra, it doesn't matter if you're ever going to use algebra. What learning algebra does is it rewires your brain, and it causes your brain to work in a way that it doesn't otherwise work. Right? And so you're stretching the brain, you're creating new neurons, you're creating new synapses, you're creating new connections. You are perfecting the art of learning, right? So everything that you learn has value. So any young student who's in school and thinks a subject doesn't interest them, if they approached education from a sharpening your sword mentality, then they wouldn't discard certain lessons or certain teachers or certain classes because they don't think they apply to them. They would learn them because they are a method of sharpening their sword, and they would understand the significance of a sharp sword. And so this is what I try to teach young people, is that it's not about the subject, it's about learning. You need to develop a love of learning. One of the great things that I've acquired throughout my life is a passionate love of learning. I actually enjoy, like some people, you know, enjoy eating a bag of potato chips and can sit down and consume the entire bag. You know, I enjoy consuming information. And so it's not a chore for me. It's you know, I value those moments when I have, you know, peace and quiet and I can sit and read a book. I mean, what a wonderful gift to have that that time to sit and do nothing but learn. So it's really how you look at things and how you approach things. You can become fascinated with football and, you know everything about every player on the football, on the various football teams. And if that's your thing and that's what you want to know about, you know, okay, great. I understand that. And I can appreciate it just like someone might want to learn about wine, right? And so they go deep into learning about wine. And anything you learn is good. But you can also pick and choose the subjects that you want to focus your time on, right? And so I focus my time right now on the future. I'm interested in new technology. I'm interested in how this story is going to unfold and what kind of a world we're in for and how I best can leverage the opportunities that are going to come my way, avoid the pitfalls, overcome the challenges, and adapt on an ongoing, constant basis. So that's, you know, that's what I enjoy thinking about and learning about today. And fortunately, I'm in a very good place in my life where I have the luxury of being able to do that and to focus my attention on those things.
Yeah, that's what I love about your book. Aside from like the very first part of the book, you talk about various values and virtues and principles. Then you go, I like that you give people some tools and some techniques of how to learn and some things to develop, like picking up an instrument, or like you said, learning algebra or trying something new. And I love the concept of carrying around your sword, because one of my favorite quotes is from Abraham Lincoln: "Give me 6 hours to chop down a tree, and I'm gonna spend 4 hours, you know, sharpening my axe."
Exactly.
It's being prepared. Focusing on learning, so we have the mental capacity to deal. Now, I want to go back and ask you this. There's a lot of people, as I coach clients, a lot of people are their confidence is shaken, they're fearful, they have limiting beliefs. What advice would you give someone that's truly struggling? How do they get on the path to flipping the script to, you know, sharpening that saw in that area of their life?
Okay, so first of all, Jay, if I were to ask you a similar question, how do you eat an elephant? What would you tell me?
Yeah, one bite at a time.
Right. So I
cook them first.
Yeah. So baby steps, mm-hmm. baby steps turn into powerful strides.
Yeah.
Right. I remember my daughter when she was, you know, maybe, I don't know, one and a half, one or two, somewhere between 1 and 2 years old, she started climbing up a stairway, a carpeted stairway in our home. And my wife and I were watching her, you know, get over the first step, and she got up on top of the first step, and then she turned and she looked at us, and we both were like clapping, right? You know, giving her praise for having got up that step. And you could see a smile in her face, break into her face. And then she went and tackled the second step. And then she looked back for further reinforcement, and we gave it to her. And then she tackled the third step. And this continued until she went all the way up to the top of the stairs. And so, you know, that's kind of a perfect metaphor for me of baby steps turning into powerful strides. It's you have to put one foot in front of the other, and you have to move forward. Action is magic. There's a guy that I saw who was interviewed many years ago. I don't know his name, but he was middle-aged to maybe he was like a 40. He appeared to be, he had a beard that was sort of grayish. He was a black man. He may have been in his late 40s or even in his 50s. And he had circumnavigated the globe on a sailboat by himself, right? A solo circumnavigation of the globe. And he had been asked, And there's been, you know, a few people who have done that. I think, you know, around 15 or 20. But he was one of the people who had done that. And he was asked by the news anchor, how did you do it? You know, how did you take off and circumnavigate the globe in a sailboat by yourself? And he said, you know something? He said, what I did that was most profound is I pushed off the shore in New York. He said, action is magic. And basically he took that action. And once he took that action, he set in motion a series of events that ultimately led to his circumnavigating the globe in a sailboat by himself. It was that act of pushing off the shore in New York that set in motion that chain of events, right? So when you have people who are overcome with a lack of confidence or they don't feel up to the challenge, what you have to do is you have to encourage them to take some form of action that is likely to result in a success, a small action that they are likely to succeed at. And the more they do that, if they constantly do that, every day they continue to do that, and every day they take new action and new steps, ultimately, they will develop a sense of confidence through their success. And those successes will build upon one another. And at the end, they will become someone that is filled with belief. I mean, I've seen this in my own life, right? So I've had all sorts of successes throughout my life. When I was in high school, I was on the debate team, right? And we kept winning and winning and winning. And we went 8-0 and we were undefeated. And I thought, you know, man, we're crushing this, right? But that success, you know, might have been the thing that led me to run for, you know, student class president or student body president. And then I would do those things and I would succeed. And then I would have that under my belt. And then I would do something else and I would succeed and I would have that under my belt. And so it's just, it builds and it builds. And then eventually when you realize that you've had so much success at all these things that you've tried, that you then don't fear anything. You're willing to go out and try anything. You know, you think you can be president, you think you can do whatever. And you know, it just builds. So this is I think how I would teach people is first of all that they must believe in themselves. Secondly, that they have good reason to believe in themselves. Look at what they've survived, look at what they've endured. You know, I spoke to a group of inmates. These are prison inmates, some of whom have committed very serious crimes. You know, some of whom have been in prison for more than 30 years. And it was a room full of about 100 of these men. And if anybody would have doubt, right, these guys would have doubt. Because they have been shut down for years and years, and they have not had success. They've had what they consider failure, and what most of the world and society considers a failure or repeated failure. And so how do you get that group to believe in themselves? And one guy was telling me that he had been in prison for like 35 years, more of his life was lived in prison than outside of prison, and that he had cancer while in prison that he overcame and was in remission. And, you know, he was wondering about what can he do with his life today? How can he move forward? How can he succeed? And my point to him was that, you know, life is about adaptation. Right? Life is about resilience and mindset and overcoming adversity. And I said, you know, as I look around this world or around this room, and I think about really all the people that I know, you are probably one of the most resilient people that I have ever met, right? You've endured 30 years in prison and cancer, right? And now you're coming out of both of them, right? You've overcome both of them. Your resilience is second to none, right? You have incredible resilience. So now the question is, how can you turn that resilience, that strength? You know, you have to be one of the strongest people that I've met. How can you turn that to your advantage? And it begins with believing in yourself. You know, understand who you are. Understand the strength that you have. And leverage that strength, right? Learn from the mistakes that you've made and embrace those as teaching lessons that teach you what not to do, right? And now you know what not to do, and now you know how strong you are, you know, now you can go forward and you can leverage that. And you begin with baby steps. You begin with small incremental steps. Go out and start interviewing for jobs. Prepare yourself for those interviews and then go on those interviews. And don't be shut down by rejection, right? Overcome the rejection, right? You've overcome much greater challenges. So you can overcome the rejection, right? You might knock on 10 doors and 9 of them might say no to you. 7 of them might slam the door in your face. You've got to be able to overcome that adversity like you've overcome cancer and like you've overcome prison. And you've got to continue to move forward and knock on more doors. One of those doors is going to open and allow you to come in. And then when you find that door that opens and allows you to come in, then you've got to seize that moment. You've got to take action that propels you forward. You've got to, you know, be responsible. You've got to show up on time. You've got to listen and take direction. You've got to accept criticism as a method to improve your performance, right? So it's all about how you think about things. And you can take that man who's been in prison for 35 or 40 years and you can change them and you can give them a new life. And you can do the same with someone who's experienced other adversity in their life, whether it's, you know, PTSD or whether it's, you know, some kind of emotional trauma or some kind of low self-image. Maybe their parents were abusive. Maybe, you know, they were in bad relationships. Maybe they're, you know, whatever the problem is, you analyze the problem. You use a helicopter perspective to analyze the problem, meaning you rise above the problem and you look at the problem from all angles and you try to understand the problem better than the person who you're helping understands it, because perhaps they're too close to it. Perhaps they don't see it from all angles. Perhaps they're not rising above and looking at everything. Maybe they just see it a certain way. Maybe they've developed a coping mechanism that has served them well, and they don't want to let go of that coping mechanism. Maybe that's a very negative coping mechanism. Maybe they feel sorry for themselves, or maybe they're the victim. And so playing the victim has gotten them some support and it's worked for them. And so they don't want to give up on being the victim, right? Because now they're losing this crutch that they've been using, right? But maybe they don't see that because they're not rising above the problem. They're in the problem. So as a performance coach, I would expect that you rise above that problem and you look at all the different issues and you objectively analyze their condition. And then you give them your best advice on how they can untangle that knot that has been created. But all of these are solvable. It begins with the proposition that all of these are solvable problems, right? This is the thing that I've done for 30 years. I've been a problem solver, right? This is This is what lawyers generally do. People come into their office and they have a problem and they hire the lawyer to solve the problem, right? Well, when you do something, when you solve problems for other people for 30 years in all manners of industry, all businesses, all sorts of people, you become a couple of things. Number one, you become very adept at problem solving, right? And you also become a broad learner, and because you're learning about, you're creating these helicopter perspectives to understand a given problem, and that problem is changing every day for 30 years. The people are different, the industries are different, the problems are different. So you not only become an adept problem solver, but you become a broad learner. And a broad learner becomes a quick learner, because you have to learn how to learn quickly, because the problems are changing every day. You don't have time to spend months trying to solve a particular problem. You have to do it, you know, more rapidly, especially if you're being paid by the hour, right? So you become a fast learner, a broad learner, and a fast learner. And there's a word for that. It's called a polymath. You become a polymath. And broad learners are polymaths. So this is essentially, you know, where my life has led, right? I solved problems for 30 years, became a broad learner, became a fast learner, and evolved into, you know, what some call a polymath.
No, that's I feel that way as I'm an engineer officer in the Army. So being a polymath and being a broad learner, I feel I'm very much a generalist. You have to know a little bit about every aspect of military engineering. So I can appreciate that, because I felt like for a lot of aspects of my life, I've been able to learn a broad spectrum of things, which has served me well as a leader. And I love what you said about, you know, leaders run toward problems as opposed to running away. And I appreciate that.
And here's another thing I'll just, you know, pass on. When I was young, my dad, you know, I was very close to my dad. My dad lived with us when before he died. And he was a wonderful, wonderful human being. But he was not an educated man. He was a very simple man from parents who immigrated from Greece. And so when I was young, I was into all sorts of things. I might have been out playing baseball or golf or, you know, something during the morning. And then I would come back in the afternoon and I might be painting, right? Well, my dad didn't paint. And so he didn't understand, you know, why his 12-year-old son is sitting on the porch painting after, you know, being out playing baseball that morning or golf or whatever the hell I was doing. And he said, you're a jack of all trades and a master of none. And I thought, wow, that's not a good thing. And I don't think he was trying to be, you know, mean or anything. I think he was trying to kind of steer me away from being a jack of all trades and trying to get me to focus on, you know, something, right? He wanted me to be excellent at something. One of the great lessons he ever told me is another story. It was, you know, if you're going to do something, do it well or don't do it at all, right? So he wanted me to do things well. And so he thought that this jack of all trades kind of disposition, this broad learner disposition, was actually a liability for me. And so that's why he commented, you're a jack of all trades and a master of none. Now, at the time, I thought, wow, that can't be a good thing. I want to be a master of something. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be a jack of all trades. And what I learned later, not until recently, really, in the last several years, I'm 63 years old, and I really only learned this recently, is that there is an end to that quote. And it goes, a jack of all trades and a master of none is still better than a master of one. And so I never knew that. And the reason that that quote says that it's still better than a master of one is that jacks of all trades become polymaths, right? They become the broad learners. And what you want to be today is, maybe back in my dad's day, you wanted to be a specialist, right? Maybe that was what everybody was looking for back 50 or 100 years ago. But today, the great achievers, the Bill Gateses, the Jeff Bezoses, the Mark Zuckerbergs, the Elon Musks, these people are polymaths. They are jack of all trades. Elon Musk, look at what he's into, right? He's into Tesla. He's into SpaceX. He's into Neuralink. He's into the Boring Company, right? He's constantly coming out with new ideas and new projects. He's very much a broad learner and a polymath, right? Jeff Bezos is not just running Amazon. He acquired the Washington Post, one of the nation's leading newspapers. He's created Blue Horizon. He's flown into space. I mean, these men are broad learners. They're polymaths, right? So don't teach your children to be specialists. Teach them to be broad learners. Teach them to develop a love of learning. Teach them to devour information and sharpen their sword throughout their life. Teach them adaptation. Teach them what some are calling the greatest 21st century skill, which is empathy. Teach them to be empathetic of others, because in order to be a leader, in order to lead men and women, you have to have empathy. You have to be able to communicate. You have to be able to collaborate. You have to be able to form coalitions, right? This is leadership, right? So that's not specialization. That's not finding one area and devoting your life to just that area. For some, that may be their chosen path, but that's not how I would direct my children. I would direct my children to be more resilient and more adaptive in the 21st century. I would teach them to be broad learners. Broad learners have the ability to draw information from all the diverse fields that they understand and use that information from all of these different diverse fields to solve complex problems, to become a complex problem solver, to become a critical thinker, right? That's a broad learner. And so that's what I think you need to be survive and thrive in the 21st century.
And I think your book does a great job of painting that picture and steering people in the right direction of how they need to, you know, adapt their mindset to change with the changing times, for sure. And so I definitely appreciate that. We're over an hour here. So what I'd like to do is maybe switch gears here a little bit. Toward the end of the interview, I always like to ask high performance questions of the individual. So some very basic things like some of your routines and whatnot. So could you tell us what your morning routine typically looks like?
Yeah. My morning routine is very simple. I think the first thing I do when I wake up is I think about gratitude. I think about my wife laying next to me and how fortunate I am to have her and to, you know, have a loving relationship. So I begin with that, and I, you know, try to always show that in the morning. And then I get up and typically I go through a hygiene routine, right? I'll, you know, do all the things that I need to do, brush my teeth, shave, take a shower, you know, get dressed for the day. Then I'll go out and I'll try to have a healthy breakfast. I'll typically try to, I'm not a big eater in the morning, but mostly what I eat is fruits or juices or an oatmeal or, you know, something healthy. And then I will just get right into working. Typically the night before, I will have created some kind of a list of things that I wanted to accomplish during the next day. And then I'll wake up in the morning and I'll consult the list and I'll start to go through it. And I'll try to move through the different things that I need to accomplish, and then move on to the next challenge or the next thing that needs to be done. And then I like to You know, I'm 63, so I'm not as hard charging as I was when I was 30 and 40. So I'll take a leisurely lunch, and I want to enjoy my day as well. It's not all about work. I want to take time to smell the roses. I want to, I enjoy meeting new people. So I often schedule meetings with people for lunch. I think lunch is a great way to get to know someone. You can have a relaxing conversation and get to know someone. So typically I'll arrange for a business related lunch, with someone that I'm likely to do business with or would like to do business with, or I'm doing business with, and, or someone that I have a relationship with. I may not be doing business with them at the time, but they're an associate or a colleague, or someone that I want to maintain a relationship with and a contact with. I'll reach out to them and schedule a lunch. Then I'll go back into the afternoon and I'll continue to complete tasks. And, you know, the end of the day, have dinner and unwind and then work through the evening, and continue to read and consume information throughout the evening and make my list for the next day.
Oh, that's great. In your book, you talk, this is something I teach, is, you know, your first hour in the morning needs to be focused on gratitude, some exercise, fueling the body, hydrating, taking care of self. And then the first 90 minutes of your workday should be what my friend Dale would say is maker's morning, manager's afternoon. You're creating in the morning, and that first 90 minutes should be blocked off. No distractions, focused on your work, what you're creating, what you're making for the day. Then the afternoon is, you know, managing. It's, you know, meetings, it's calls, it's all those other activities that you need to get done. So
yeah, I appreciate that. And that's a great, you know, general kind of approach. But obviously, again, on the theme of adaptation, right? Every day changes. Every day has new contingencies and new things pop up and schedules change and people's appointments change. And so you're constantly adapting to that change in workflow as well.
What three books have made the greatest impact on you? Maybe what books have you gifted the most to other people?
Geez, let's see. Well, when I was younger, John Steinbeck's Of Mice and Men was the first book that I really enjoyed reading. Then let's see. A formative book was David Ogilvy. Wrote a book called Ogilvy on Advertising, which I have a very strong interest in creativity. And so I once thought I would get into the advertising industry and become a creative director. And so I was reading probably when I was, you know, 10 or 11 or 12, I was reading Ogilvy on Advertising. And Ogilvy gave me a number of pieces of information that I still think are very, very valuable. I talk about them in Seize Your Destiny, A Roadmap to Success. One of the things that Ogilvy gave me was the helicopter perspective, the idea of rising above a problem, looking at it from all angles, and that's called a helicopter perspective. And not a lot of us use it. A lot of us kind of look at things from, you know, where we are, and we don't try to rise above, you know, for example, if I'm in a negotiation with someone else, I'm not typically, a lot of people are not typically thinking about the other guy and what he wants and what he's trying to achieve and what options might work for him. You know, they're thinking about what do they want and how are they going to get what they want and how are they going to convince the other side what they want. And it's all kind of from their perspective. Well, a helicopter perspective would teach you that that's not the way to negotiate, that you need to look at things from all angles. You need to understand what the other side needs and wants. And you need, and it is your job to try to satisfy their needs and wants while getting everything that you want or more, right? You can do that. You can get what you want and more while still satisfying what they want, perhaps in a different way. You know, there are all sorts of creative options that are possible. And so you look at interests rather than positions. Interests are what underlie the positions. I tell you I want a raise as your employee. I come in and I want a raise. So you're looking at that and saying, well, they want more money, right? And so, you know, you're thinking, well, the negotiation is going to center around, you know, do I give them more money or don't I? And how much money do I give them, right? And there are other ways of looking at that negotiation, like understanding the interests underlying the positions, right? So why are they asking you for more money? So ask them, you know, why is it that you feel you need, do you need more money or do you just want more money? And if they said, no, I need more money. Well, why do you need more money? Well, my you know, daughter is about to start school and, you know, she's going to be going to the university and the tuition is going to be this and that. And in order to pay for it, I need a raise, right? So now you know the interest underlying the position, right? Now, how can that help you? Well, you might figure out a way to satisfy that interest. You might be aware of a scholarship that's available to, you know, someone that might, you know, her daughter or her child might qualify for. Or you might know someone at the university, or you might know a professor who could write a letter of recommendation, or you might have other kind of value adds that you can bring to the table that could act as a substitute for money. If you could make a phone call, in many instances, someone who's in that position could make a phone call to someone at the university and perhaps arrange for someone to be considered for a scholarship, right? That could obviate the need for the raise, right? So there are value adds to this helicopter perspective and to this interest analysis and to going deeper and asking questions and learning more, right? So anyway, these are some of the things that I practice every day now and that, you know, people can profit from if they approach things the same way.
Yeah, by you describing that, it reminds me of, I'm not sure if you're familiar with the work of Jocko Willink, but he talks about being able to detach and leadership development in the military. That's one thing that we would have to focus on with, like, I was a trainer for lieutenants in the engineer schoolhouse. And, you know, they would get caught up. They we would receive contact and the lieutenant who's, you know, leadership training is in charge of the group. He would start firing his rifle and be like, stop, lieutenant. That's not your job. If you're firing your rifle, you know, you're not leading and managing the situation well. You got to be able to detach. That rifle is for your own personal protection. Your weapon system is the radio, and you need to be able to detach and see the bigger situation so you can make the appropriate decision and maneuver, you know, your other elements where they need to be. And that's difficult to do. So I like how you said the helicopter perspective, because I just think, you know, okay, hopping in a helicopter and you're getting that vantage point. Not easy to do, but incredibly, if you want to advance your leadership, that's definitely something you need to adopt for sure.
I love the analogy that the radio is your weapon.
Yeah. You
know, not the rifle.
It's not your rifle. Like, lieutenant, stop shooting. Like, that's for your own personal protection. Or if you want to point to where you want one of your squad leaders to shoot, then fire off a couple rounds. But if you're engaging in the enemy, you've lost the control of the situation. So
yeah, that's a great analogy, because, you know, for the other members of the troop or the company, their rifle may well be their weapon, but for him, it's the ability to communicate with all of them.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. So, and it's being able to detach and get the helicopter perspective. I love that. So one more thing before we wrap up, you talk about in your book, meditation and how important it is. I know Tim Ferriss talks about, you know, 80% of the world's highest performers have a meditation practice. The other 20% may have some other form of meditation practice that's probably outside the norm. Do you have a meditative practice?
Yeah, I don't do traditional meditation, where I'm an advocate of it, and I think that it's a wonderful thing for people to do. it's not something that is part of my routine. But I did do yoga, and I think that at the end of the day, I'll find some quiet time, mm-hmm. To myself. And that, I guess, would be my form of unwinding and meditation. But you know, it's a tremendous practice to open your mind more and to expand your range of thought. I also love going outdoors. Mm-hmm. I find that being outdoors, whether it's, you know, at the beach or it's in a forest or any place in nature, is incredibly rejuvenating. And so that would be, I guess, a form of meditation as well.
Yeah, like I said, 80%, you know, have a practice of probably sitting down and doing mantras and whatnot. But even like going for a walk, for a stroll, a lot of my meditation might just be walking outside. In doing so, you're just kind of disconnecting from everything.
Yeah, and I do that.
Yeah. So I think it's important to do. So I know you mentioned that. So I was curious to what you do. So, well, at the end of the interview, I always like to pass the microphone off to my guest and maybe ask a question of me. What question do you have?
So how long have you been doing this?
I've been doing this for, I'm coming up on my 1 year anniversary. So just about a year. And it's been awesome. I'm still in the military, so I retire next year and I plan on doing this full time. So that's what I'm doing. I've had some fantastic conversations with some amazing people, and I appreciate our conversation today. So thank you for taking the time.
Yeah, well, I think it's wonderful that you're doing this because first of all, it's a great way for you to transition out of the military into something else that you can have an impact and be successful at. So I definitely love the fact that you're doing it. I also believe that our answers moving forward as a society really depend upon people like you who are doing what you're doing. That it's really, government is not going to save us. Okay. Mm. Government is not going to come in like the cavalry and cure all of our problems or deal with all of our challenges. It's really going to be people like you, Jay, who are out there, individuals helping other individuals, right? I believe that we are profoundly interdependent as human beings. And that if you look at the animal kingdom, there are many examples of this. You know, flocks of sterling and schools of fish and packs of wolves and ants and bees, and the way that they perform as a group. And if you read Sapiens, which is one of my favorite books, Sapiens talks about the social fabric, the social fictions that we create to collaborate, and that how man in the beginning could collaborate only as large as maybe 100 to 150 people. And because you didn't know and trust and develop a relationship with more people than that, right? This might have been the people in your cave or people that you developed your relationship with and the people in your tribe. You know, and eventually we moved from tribes to cities, and then we, you know, formed churches, and then we, you know, formed fraternities and political parties and clubs and you know, we think of ourselves in terms of groups, like Americans, right? We're all Americans. And these fictions, these social fictions that we've created, whether it's a group or an entity or a country, those are the fabric that bind us. Mm-hmm. And allow us to collaborate with one another. And I believe that as individuals, we have a certain level of power and capacity. But as groups, we have a multiplying effect and a much greater capacity for achievement and progress and getting things done. And so it's people helping people, lifting up others. We can't allow large segments of our society to radically underperform in a way that makes them very hopeless and lack affirmation or lack ambition or belief in themselves. By bringing others up, it will ultimately make the world safer and stronger for all of us, right? You don't want people that are unable to succeed in life, like those prisoners. You don't want them at the grocery store waiting in the parking lot, you know, to get a bag of food from your wife when she's going to her car. And so to create a safer society for all of us, we have to lift up the lives of others. We are, in fact, very profoundly dependent upon one another. So I applaud the fact that you're out there helping people and that this is how you're transitioning from the military. I think it's a great gift that you're bringing to others. So thank you.
Oh, well, thank you. I appreciate that. I got into this work just wanting to make a difference. It kind of, there's some selfishness in it as well. You mentioned you're writing a book for your daughters. I have triplet 13-year-old daughters, and I want to leave a legacy for them. And I feel that this work, it's impactful. For the longest time, I stayed in the military for as long as I did because I didn't know what I wanted to do next. But I started looking at what were some of the unique skills and what did I appreciate about military service? Well, it's mentoring and coaching others. It's the service aspect and how can I serve beyond the uniform? It took me a long time to figure this out. Well, I have a lot of skills. I've had a lot of things that I have developed over the years of service that I can translate. And this seems to be a natural fit. And, you know, our mutual friend Colby, he had me come on and we were speakers together on the same stage, but that was the very first time that someone had asked me to come speak in public like that. And I had to face my fear and it really unlocked the path that I'm on now. It really gave me courage and confidence that, you know what, I can do this podcast. Colby saw something in me to invite me out to do this. And it set the tone for where I'm at now. So I'm really grateful for that.
I want you to know, I see it too. It's obvious that you have this potential and this gift, and it's a great use and application of it. And one day, your daughters are going to be watching and they're going to be learning and they're going to be inspired. And, maybe they'll decide they want to become life coaches with dad, who knows? They'll gain an awareness and a strength through watching you. Or maybe they'll want to do something similar, or maybe they'll want to do something with you. You never know how you doing what you're doing. I mean, one of your daughters could walk in the room and see you doing a podcast and get inspired and decide that she wants to do something similar. And, she'll be sitting down behind that mic and she'll have her own thing and she'll be doing her own thing. And you'll have launched that through your own efforts to launch your podcast. You may launch, many ships from others that emulate what you're doing.
I hope so. Right now I'm trying to inspire them to make their bed and take out the trash. And that's difficult from a high performance perspective. And my greatest leadership challenge now is leading my children. But yeah, I hope so. They definitely are watching what we're doing. And so I hope that happens. I truly do. So, well, thank you so much, George, for taking the time. I have so many more questions and I know we're limited on time. I'm really fascinated to know, one of the things before we go, you used to be a Republican, but in your book, you talk about the challenges the issues that matter, right? What are the issues that we need to be focused on? Yeah. And just, the long list, global warming, things like that. It made me think like, oh, hey, because that's one of the things that I recall is I felt like my political party had left me a long time ago. And we could get into a whole conversation just about that. And I'm very curious about that, but maybe another time.
I mean, I can tell you very quickly that I was a Republican because I believed that if you gave a man a fish, you fed him for a day. And if you taught a man to fish, you fed him for a lifetime. I am no longer a Republican, and I'm not a Democrat. I'm nonpartisan. And part of the reason is that I don't believe that Republicans are teaching men to fish anymore. You know, and they just don't want to give away fish. And I agree about not wanting to give away fish, but I really believe we need to be teaching men to fish. And so that's one thing that separates me from the Republican Party. And the other thing is that, you know, it's not that I disagree with a lot of Donald Trump's policies, but I disagree with him as a human being. I don't respect him as a human being. You know, there are certain things about him that I respect. I respect the fact that he's close to his family and that he loves his family. I respect the fact that he's accomplished great things in his life. I respect the fact that he was, you know, dealing with an incredibly difficult challenge and was very unfairly treated by the media. But I don't, he's just not my kind of guy. He's just, he's not somebody that I think that this country of 335 million people can find better people to represent them than who we have had in our elections, right? Yeah. So I'm not a fan of Donald Trump. I'm very much not a fan of Hillary Clinton. You know, have a strong dislike of Hillary Clinton. I think that Joe Biden is a good man, but I think he's well past his prime. And, you know, I don't have confidence in his leadership. I don't like some of the decisions that he's made. I just think that the country is underserved, grossly underserved. By the people that we have elected to office, and that we deserve much better. And I think we should all have higher standards when it comes to selecting candidates.
Yeah.
And that these are not the people that I think should be leading the country.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. I had considered maybe getting into politics, and I think you alluded to it earlier. I think I can make a greater impact doing this type of work than trying to navigate that, which is sad, because there's such a void in leadership, and it's like, how do we get out of the situation that we're in regards to Washington D.C. and our local.
It's by demanding more, you know. It's by not settling for less, right? Yeah. We have become way too complacent. So what the problem that we've got is that we all have all these challenges in our lives, our daily lives. And they occupy us, right? So we're trying to get the kids off to school. You're trying to manage your three daughters. You're trying to keep a roof over your head, pay the mortgage, you know, feed the family. You know, you're take care of your elderly parents. You know, we're all dealing with similar challenges. And these challenges have become, you know, so significant with rising inflation and stagnating wages. Our challenges have just seemed to grow and take up more and more of our time. So who has time to think about global warming? And who has time to think about, you know, improving our choices for president? But the truth is that we don't have the luxury. We don't have the luxury not to think about those things. We think we don't have the luxury to think about those things. In truth, we don't have the luxury to not think about those things. We have to do it all. We have to do everything that we're doing already, and we have to do more. We have to be more engaged in civic activities and in things like elections and things like, you know, having a voice and expressing an opinion and being able to lead and teach others. We have to do more.
Yeah, that's a challenge, and that's difficult to do. I mean, that's what we talk about here, is doing hard things. How do we manage it all? But yeah, I think your book is great. I think that I'm going to link it in the show notes here, and I'm going to recommend people pick it up. And I think you make some very compelling cases about, you know, the mindset, giving actionable tips and tools to, you know, to sharpen your sword. And I love all the topics that you have that we need to pay attention to. And I just appreciate the work that you're doing.
Well, thank you, Jay. I really appreciate you as well, and I appreciate being here.
How can people get in contact with you, George?
They can go to georgejchanos.com. It's right on the screen. So that's the spelling of my name. If you go to georgejchanos.com, it'll give you all my contact information and how to reach me directly. Just send me an email. It'll also give you links to my book, or my books. Maybe another time we'll talk about blockchain and NFTs.
Yeah, I would love to. I'm fascinated by that. So I will link all that contact information into the show notes, and I'd love to have you come back on and talk about those topics. So I appreciate it, George.
Okay. All right. Well, great to meet you, and I appreciate it.
Yeah, likewise. For everyone listening, keep doing hard things. We'll see. Thank you so much for listening to today's episode of the Do Hard Things podcast. I hope that you got some great nuggets. In fact, I would love to hear your takeaways. So feel free to contact me on social media. Let me know what you thought. Take a screenshot of this, put it out there on social media, let people know that you listened to it. And, you know, there's so much negativity in the world that this is a great way to get someone to listen to the message and put some positivity out in the world. Leave a review if you haven't done so already, as that goes a long way to expanding our audience reach. And if you would like to get some Do Hard Things gear, visit the shop. The link is posted below in the show notes. And head on over and show the world that you do hard things. And it means a lot to me that that you would support the show. And you know, there's when you wear this, like people are wearing these things, taking on difficult challenges. And it does. When I wear this, it gives me a sense of confidence. I mean, this is my mantra. This is the mantra that's gotten me to this point in my life. And we are all capable of doing hard things. And so show the world that that you do hard things. And we appreciate you. If you want to grow with other people, if you want to learn and grow, if you're ready to take yourself to the next level, you can apply for one-on-one coaching, join the Forge, and join the Do Hard Things Nation Facebook page, where you can connect with other like-minded people and engage there. So in the meantime, keep doing hard things, and we will see you guys in the next episode.